I'm Reenita Malhotra Hora, Director of Marketing and Communications at SRI International, and you're watching The Dish. Vision and learning. Can you tell us a little bit more about what this org is about and why it exists here?
Sure. We are part of the Center for Vision Technology within SRI, which in turn is part of Information and Communication Sciences. And within the Center for Vision Technology, we started out originally at a time when applying machine learning to computer vision was still considered somewhat newfangled. Now, if you look at the state of the art today, machine learning and computer vision are almost synonymous. At this point, we occupy the applied research space. We are somewhere between a university and industry, which means that while we need to have a grasp of basic research and often produce it ourselves, we are also on the hook to make things that actually work. And so our imperative is very problem driven, driven by necessarily by some scientific principle, or even by some kind of market need per se.
Who comes up with these problems? Are these problems that sort of exist in society, or because I would have thought they would be market driven, given that we are in the field of applied research?
Sometimes it comes out of a customer imperative, right? But sometimes the customer doesn't even know that that needs to be their imperative. So sometimes there is a push and sometimes there is a pull. And these things come from having a broader view of the interplay of market needs, requirements, and technological trends. In today's world, especially after the advent of deep learning, now people are talking about how data is the new oil and all this, you must have heard. And certainly data-driven techniques are very powerful. So then we have to step back and look at ourselves to try to position ourselves in this new landscape.
How are we different from some of these players that you've mentioned, Google, Facebook, others?
We are a non-profit research institute. Our mission is to make people more productive, safer, which means that we are not directly driven by market needs, as I mentioned earlier. We are not overwhelmed by them. We are not incentivized to use data in the ways that the big techs use data. We are more incentivized to look for interesting applications that will go towards our mission. One strength is that because we occupy this applied research space and we work for government clients who have much more appetite for risk, we are able to go in and really explore very risky kinds of ideas, which often, despite all protestations to the contrary, the private sector does not have the same level of appetite for those kinds of risk.
You would think it would be the other way around.
You would think that, yes. We are certainly very nimble. We work in very small groups. We work very closely with the universities. We are not tied to quarter by quarter assessments of who we are and what we are. So all of those things are good. Now, while we are nimble, because we are small, then our smallness also works against us. So we certainly don't have the kinds of data resources and computational resources that the big techs have. And so that motivates us to look for problems that are not going to be solved by those kinds of resources. And I would argue that throughout there has been some evidence that just throwing a lot of data at a problem is not going to solve the problem. Mm-hmm. That's one part. Some problems are certainly like that. But then there are some problems where you just don't have the luxury of having this kind of data.
If data is the new oil, then as a layperson, I would think that you have to have large data sets to even begin to think about how to solve the problems. But you're indicating that there's applications out there that we are working on that do not require that. So what is the difference? Could you give me an example?
Suppose I'm dealing with some medical condition, say, and the only way I can get data is through some intrusive test. Now, can you imagine subjecting a human being to multiple intrusions just because you want a lot of data? You just cannot. I mean, that just cannot be done. From a safety point of view, you may not be able to intrude that many times without compromising the safety of the individual, right?
Absolutely.
So there are some problems like that. Let's look at, say, military and law enforcement. You have an adversary that you need to deal with, right? Clearly, the adversary is not keen on giving you a lot of data about themselves. To give some kind of extreme example, North Korea will not greet a lot of overflights by drones trying to gather information about North Korea with enthusiasm. Which means that very often, information about adversaries is going to be sparse. It will come from multiple modalities. So when you think of how how certain terrorists have been captured and so forth in the war against terror, you know, without making any very big claims, I can make a very simple claim here, which is that multiple pieces of evidence had to be gathered together before any such operation could have been attempted. And all these bits and pieces have come from very sparse kind of information. There's a hint here, there's a hint there. So those are some examples of very critical problems that don't necessarily come with a lot of data or necessarily even give you the possibility of, in fact, gathering a lot of data. We are also looking at multimodality, so combining, so making up for shortage of data by looking at other modalities where the data might be plentiful. So, for instance, text is plentifully available in social media. Can you leverage that text and help it analyze the images? We have an element of serendipity in what we do. So, we have applications and we have core technologies. And sometimes it becomes very difficult for us to tell you, which is the head and which is the tail. So sometimes the application that wags the core technologies and sometimes the core technologies that wag the applications.
For example?
When we started working on social media analytics, so in social media, as everyone knows, you are interested in propagation of influence. So their influence is the currency, right? If you are influential, then you are successful in social media.
So social media analytics for us is not about the communication or the entertainment factor. It's specifically about looking to see who or what is influential.
But here is the interesting thing. In the process, we have also had to understand something about the entertainment factor. So this is what I'm saying, that you start out with a certain point of view.
Mm-hmm.
And then as you start engaging with the problem, you realize that so to carry out social media analytics, you have to actually understand the interplay of text and images. That serendipitously, led us to actually figure out how Instagram works.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we worked on Instagram, we found that, look, we can't step away from entertainment. The entire objective of Instagram, arguably, is entertainment.
Absolutely.
But at the same time, you have to kind of go under that, right? You say, okay, this is the broad concept, but then you realize every important commercial entity seems to have a presence on Instagram,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right? So that means that this is a serious business and people are achieving serious business objectives with these kinds of platforms. So because we have worked with, for example, with image and text,
yes.
We have been able to combine these. And we have developed certain multimodal technologies which we are now trying to apply to things like robot navigation. The idea is the robot also has multiple sensors on it and it is trying to make sense of multiple inputs at the same time. Basically, the same underlying techniques that we developed to navigate the forest of text and images and audio in social media. If you're going to talk about trying to computationalize the human experience, that is a much deeper problem than just having a boatload of data. So that's one part. The other part is I don't think big techs are incentivized to share their, you know, because these are strongly guarded corporate secrets, really. If Facebook is figuring out exactly how to give you the content that you are interested in, I'm curious to know what is the incentive they would have to tell the rest of the world exactly what, you know, what their algorithm is. I mean, maybe there's a reason I'm missing it, but I'm not seeing it.
Right.
So I'm not seeing a powerful incentive for big techs to necessarily open these kinds of details. We are guided by a non-profit mission, and so we have the privilege of working in a manner where we try to make something that works, but then it rests on our spirit of exploration, right, within the science of things, to devise a solution and then to actually then also share it with the community, as I said, because we are interested in making people safer, more productive, and so forth.
And that brings us back to our mission here at SRI International, which is to make the world a better place together.